Okay, guys, I'm going to point something out that everybody seems to not notice quite easily. The greatest argument against the Trinity is the fact that the Book of Hebrews denies it, that the Trinity didn't even exist in the 4th century. No one knew about a Trinity. There was no Trinity. There was no theorem of the Trinity. The predominant deity Christ view was modalism, and the opposing view was Arianism. Modalism and Arianism in the 4th century. And that was what was battling. It wasn't the Trinity fighting against Arianism. There was no such thing. The Trinity actually was a compromise between Arianism and modalism. If you take the pre-existent Christ of the Arianism, and you know, the Son of God and all that, and then you move that here, and then you take the deity of Christ of modalism, and you move that here, then you have the Trinity. That's what it is. So when they're preaching, Trinitarians preaching the pre-existent Christ, they quickly become an Arian and start presenting Arian presentations. But then when they start presenting the deity of Christ, they quickly start presenting the modalist presentation. And a lot of Trinitarians will deny that we couldn't possibly be presenting the oneness presentation. But the fact of the matter is, when you look at the proof text, when you put them all together of the Trinity, it rules out the Father. The Father gets ruled out rather quickly. For instance, we go to John 12. They suggest that Isaiah 6 is being mentioned, and Jesus is the only one being mentioned in context, which isn't true. Father's actually being mentioned. There's someone commissioning Jesus. They say that Isaiah 6 is referring to Jesus, and that's where Jesus was commissioned. So Jesus was commissioned by Jesus. Jesus raised Jesus from the dead. Jesus created all things. Jesus created the heavens and the earth. Jesus created the new creation. Jesus died for your sins. Jesus rose again, but he raised himself from the dead, of course. Jesus ascended upon high with his own power. Jesus. And then the question starts to arise through the Trinitarian presentation, what did the Father do anyway? Well, the only way it would work is if Jesus was the Father. And that's what it is. And I've said that a long time ago, and they just deny that altogether. And they say, well, this is the theorem of the oneness, and this is the theorem of the Trinity. Well, this is the presentation of the oneness, which is the same presentation of the Trinity, until you want to present the pre-existent Christ. Then you go to Arianism, and you have the exact same presentation of Arians as well. But there was no such thing as the Trinity as far as the 4th century, and I'm going to demonstrate. It's not orthodoxy. It is a compromise. We go to Hebrews 1:4. Hebrews is set up as a book. Now, this is an obscure book that was not accepted until it was put into the canon prior to the 4th century canon. It wasn't accepted. The early church didn't accept the book of Hebrews. It wasn't widely circulated. It wasn't talked about. It's just obscure, you know, whatever it was. But it's presented by Trinitarians as a book to Hebrew people trying to convince them that Jesus is the Christ. Now, it may have started out that way. Of course, Paul was a preacher to the Gentiles, not to the Hebrews. Now, he may have took time to write a letter to the Hebrews. That would have been fine. We see the last half of the book of Hebrews looks just like something that Paul would have written. But the first two chapters don't make any sense. Now, why was this book put into the canon of Scripture during the 4th century, right, as the Roman Catholic Church had been established? Well, it was put in there. This obscure book was taken, it was doctored up, it was thrown in there for a purpose, and that purpose was an anti-Arian presentation. That's what it was. It was an anti-Arian presentation. We have the first two chapters clearly trying to separate Jesus from the angels. Jesus is not an angel. Now, what Hebrew or Jewish person of that day believed that Jesus was an angel of God? They didn't. But here we have someone trying to convince someone who believes that Jesus is an angel that he is not. Hebrews 1 verse 4, being made so much better than the angels, as he hath inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. For unto which of the angels said at any time, separating Jesus from the angels, clearly, separating him from the angels. To which of the angels they say at any time, thou art my son, this day I have begotten thee. And again, I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. Now notice this, I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. This is Nathan's promise to David, which is thought to have been fulfilled in Solomon. Then we get into Jeremiah and the Babylonian captivity, and they begin to naysay God and say, hey, you made this promise about Solomon that his throne would never end, and here we are going into captivity. And Jeremiah deals with that and says, no, the days will come the days will come. It wasn't Solomon, so they were mistaken. David was mistaken. The days will come that I will fulfill my promise with the house, with Judah and with Israel. That's what he had said. He said it would be the branch of righteousness, which was obviously Jesus. So in Jeremiah 33, we can clearly demonstrate that this is referring to Jesus at where he had said, I shall be a father unto him, and he shall be a son unto me. And the author of Hebrews picks up on this, but uses it for a different purpose. Now, I would use it to demonstrate that Jesus wasn't the Son of God and the Trinity didn't exist. Now, the author of Hebrews is using it to demonstrate that Jesus wasn't an angel of God, a pre-existent angel of God, because he was not yet, at this time that the prophecy was made, the Son of God. Do you see that? It's really easy to see that. This is a modalist, a oneness believer, and I'll demonstrate that, trying to demonstrate that Jesus is not the Son of God at the time that that prophecy was made. That's exactly what he's doing here. So obviously not a Trinitarian, guys. Obviously, let us read on. But unto the Son, he saith, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever, and the scepter of thy righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. Thou hast loved righteousness and hated iniquity. Therefore, God, even thy God, has anointed thee with oil gladness above thy fellows. And thou, Lord, in the beginning hast laid the foundation of the earth and the heavens the work of thy hands. Uh-oh. Okay. So the Father supposedly says to the Son, in the beginning, the heavens were the work of your hands. You laid the foundations of the heavens and the earth, and they are the work of your hands. This is the Father speaking to the Son. But we go to what he's actually quoting here in Psalms 102. And we read, starting in verse 23. Now, a Trinitarian won't start in verse 23 because that lays out the context which they can't handle. He weakened my strength in a way, he shortened my days. I said, O my God, take me not away in the midst of my days. Thy years are throughout all generations. Of old hast thou laid the foundations of the earth, and the heavens are the work of thy hands. Now here we see that the author of Hebrews is saying that this is the Father speaking to the Son, when it's actually the Son speaking to the Father. Now the only way that that would work is if you believe that the Father is the Son. Okay? You are believing that the Father is the Son, so you're taking a quote. You're taking a quote from the Old Testament where it has the Son speaking to the Father. Now, when did the Son shorten the Father's days? When did the Son weaken the Father in the way? When did the Father plead with the Son not to let him perish? Never did that. But it was the Son who said these things to the Father. But because the Father said it, because Jesus is the Father, according to the author of Hebrews, then it could be attributed to the Father, because the Son did not yet exist. You see, that's oneness. It's oneness. It goes on. It goes on. If we go into Hebrews 2, verse 5. For teenagers he had not put in subjection to the world to come, whereof we speak. Again, Jesus is not an angel. But on a certain place he testifies, saying, what is man that thou art mindful of him, the son of man which thou visited him? Now, this is a quote that refers to Adam and his descendants, but the author of Hebrews is trying to suggest it's referring to Jesus. It's referring to Jesus. Thou madest him a little lower than the angels, and crownest him with glory and honor, and didst set him over the work of thine hands. Okay, now, remember, he said in Hebrews 1 and 10, just prior, same statement, he said that the heavens and the earth are works of Jesus' hands. And then he's saying that Jesus was made a little lower than the angels, and then Jesus, who the works of his hands, Jesus set those works under himself in a different state, which was in his humanity. That's what it's saying. It's oneness. Jesus is the Father. See, Jesus created all things and then set all things under himself. Okay? It's oneness. You see that? Really simple there, guys. And then we get into Hebrews 2 and 8, and some say, I believe this is the verse they say is a forgery and wasn't in the older Hebrew documents. Thou hast put all things in subject under his feet, for in him he put all things in subject under him, and left nothing that is put under him. But now we see not yet all things put under him. For he had, and we go to 1 Corinthians 15:27, which is actually quoting. It's actually quoting 1 Corinthians 15:27, guys. So those of you who say this is the fourth letter of Paul, you better watch it. For he hath put all things under his feet, but when he saith all things are put under him, it is manifest that he is expected, which is did put all things under him. Okay, now Jesus is returning when he had put all things under him. If this is the Father, Jesus created all things and then puts all things under himself, guys. Now, notice this. It's saying that Jesus is the Father. So the he that put all things under him is the same person. It's the Father. That's what he's trying to convey here. Easily seen here. And it goes on. He goes on saying that he wasn't made in the image. He wasn't made, took on him the image of an angel. He took on him the image of his brethren. Of course, again, a false quote suggesting that the angels are not tempted, so he wanted to be tempted as his brethren, and that's why he became human. Angels are tempted as well, but he's just conveying here throughout the first two chapters that Jesus is not an angel and that Jesus is the Father. That's what he's doing. And that Jesus had no former state as the Son of God. There was no former state. When the Father came down, turned himself into a human, became the Son of God, because the Father put all things in this different state, he put all things under himself as the Son of God. And that's exactly what it's saying. Can't believe that people are overlooking this. Now, why would he be saying these things to a Hebrew person? Makes absolutely no sense. Nobody in the Jewish faith believed that Jesus was an angel of God. Nobody believed that. Or the heavenly host as an angel. Now, an angel can be a human, a minister, or a preacher, but it's actually heavenly host. And no one believed that, so why would he be trying to convince the Hebrew people that Jesus wasn't an angel? He wasn't. This was an obscure book taken, fixed, put into the canon as an anti-Aryan document, but obviously demonstrates that the predominant view, now, I'm not going to say that they were ignorant to not see these things that I'm pointing out to you. They saw them. Obviously, the oneness view was the predominant view of the Roman Catholic Church while the canon of Scripture was being put together, this last one that we now use. Clearly seen, clearly demonstrated, easy. Don't know why everybody's missing that. Y'all bless those that are here.